Välkomna allihopa. Welcome. We're very excited about today's lecture. A few months ago when we were thinking about possible people to invite in connection with our Corbusier exhibition, Rem Koolhaas' name came up and we were all agreeing that he would be the ideal person, and unbelievably enough, he's now here. Welcome, Rem Koolhaas. Mr. Koolhaas doesn't really need an introduction, but let me remind us of a few basic facts. In 1975, he co-founded OMA, Office for Metropolitan Architecture. He has published extensively, and I think most of us here know the best-known books, such as Delirious New York from 1978, Small, Medium, Large, Extra Large, which came out in 1995. And the most recent, I think, the most recent large publication is from 2011, called Project Japan, Metabolism Talks, a book that Rem did together with the curator Hans-Ulrich Obrist. Buildings, well, there are many buildings, but most recently, I just want to mention China Central Television, CCTV, in Beijing, and, among other things, the new headquarters for the Rothschild Bank in London. Rem Koolhaas has received almost every possible prize, except for one prize, which is he's not here for tonight. Just for me to remind you, he did get the Lifetime Achievement Award at the Venice Biennale, and also in 2000, the Pritzker Prize. Tonight, Rem Koolhaas is going to talk about recent preoccupations, architecture, and exhibition making. After the talk, I think we'll have a chance to ask questions and have a little bit of an exchange. Please give a warm welcome to Mr. Koolhaas.
I actually will not talk about exhibition making, but I will talk about the interaction between art and architecture in the last 20 years. So it is kind of related to the context here of the museum. I first want to kind of present a number of contrasts. This is a picture from 95, and anyone assumes that this guy will have a very charged evening, and that waiting in front of him is probably adventure and certainly the unknown. And in that sense, it's kind of representative of a kind of culture that appreciates the unknown. This is 60 years later, again a guy, but you can see that whatever happens in this environment will not be adventurous, it will be predictable, it will be safe, and he probably only has a clean set of underwear in his suitcase. This is a kind of picture of 1909, and it is for me a very exciting picture. It is the Grand Palais in Paris, it was just finished at the time. Here you see one of the earliest Zeppelins, kind of floating through the nave over a boulevard crowded with people thinking about the notion of progress, and on either side contraptions, planes that may or may not have been able to fly, but in any case clearly a euphoric moment on the march of progress. 100 years later, it's the same space, the same shape, but it dominates completely, and it is art. And you see some kind of people crowding away, and I would say it's not a euphoric moment at all. It's maybe a kind of scary moment, or a moment where art really becomes kind of highly dominant. And for me, in this kind of interval, we lost a lot. This is Richard Serra in 81, and you see he behaves the way artists used to behave, kind of challenging expectation, being obnoxious in terms of interfering with kind of circulation, pedestrian circulation. Thank you. Interfering with pedestrian circulation, being kind of in general nasty. And here, about 30 years later, you see again art, but instead of being an obstacle in the public realm and therefore an incident and a kind of form of sabotage or aggression, it is now completely displayed in a kind of harmless way as an attraction, and you don't kind of expect the kind of sparks to fly that actually did fly in the case of Richard Serra, to the point where this was forcibly kind of removed and eventually parked somewhere else. This is the director of the Tate in the early 90s with his vision that an enormous industrial building could be turned into a cathedral for art or accommodation for the Tate Modern, as it is called. And it was very clear that the monumentality of the architecture was perhaps the greatest attraction of the building. And as one of the people participating in the competition, we were told to really respect that monumentality, as Sergeant Dumont did with the famous Turbine Hall 10 years later. But what is the effect of the Turbine Hall? The Turbine Hall has kind of provoked a series of artistic installations that are each enormous in size, sometimes deeply exciting in terms of content. But if you look at certain kind of repetitive elements of the thematics that are being introduced in this enormous space, you begin to realize that there is perhaps a crisis point where art, having to fill these enormities, having to adjust to a larger and larger expectation of value, can only do so by opting a kind of apocalyptic content and being almost pathetic in its direness and warningness. So here you see the famous kind of son of Olsen. I think, and in this case it is kind of almost literally the case, it is an art that you can only understand or experience in a state of submission. And I'm kind of really wondering whether that is kind of really a healthy thing, or whether, you know, a state of submission is kind of really what art ought to demand for itself. Submission may be one thing, but at least not at the exclusion of all the other elements such as doubt, skepticism, and others. So for me, it's not kind of problem. In all these things, what we have seen is kind of basically an increase in the kind of accommodation for art, a very physical respect shown to art in the form of larger and larger spaces, larger and larger architectural accommodation. But ultimately, I kind of really wonder whether the kind of brutality of the Richard Serra moment isn't a kind of more interesting or relevant form of interfering with the kind of world, then all of these ultimately very glamorous displays of, on the one hand, incredible formal competence, but also inevitably glamour. So for me, it's not kind of really a surprise that somebody, Hall Foster, has declared a kind of crisis, the art and architecture complex. And basically, if I look at the architecture, I would kind of say that the crisis is really upon us. I think that where, of course, the Guggenheim in Bilbao was a kind of incredibly exciting building when it happened. I think there have been kind of later, recently, law of diminishing returns, where you know the sheer imagination, the sheer boldness, the sheer unusual combination of building and site have been kind of watered down, and where in a way the unpredictable has become the totally unexpected. So I would say that what we are kind of witnessing is two bubbles, you know, kind of one in architecture and one in art. Bubbles can only burst, and I think that the architectural bubble has burst first in the last 4 or 5 years. I think that we are now a kind of a really group that is kind of deeply resented. We are called star architects, although none of us kind of really likes that name or thinks it's kind of justified. But it is a name that kind of really kills our repertoire and makes it very difficult for us to do kind of serious things. If you look at what we've been doing, I think it is also kind of understandable. We have kind of reached a point of diminishing returns in talent and extravagance. And somehow this sum total of what we do seems to be kind of less than the kind of individual ingenuity of these things. And what is forever outside our grasp is the kind of more traditional role of the architect that you see here, kind of basically a boring guy who is kind of looking at a series of boring drawings, who doesn't even have to look at what is happening behind him, because he knows that whatever these workers do is the kind of completely exact execution of what he imagined. And that kind of one-to-one relationship kind of doesn't really exist anymore. And what it also means is that doing good and being serious, kind of, for instance, in terms of social housing, has been kind of forever outside our reach. So I don't think it will take a long time that the art world will also explode, and so then we will be able to celebrate the kind of simultaneous bursting of the two bubbles, and that will kind of probably be a very exciting moment. But I will kind of simply present in this context a number of projects that we have done. And I'm not showing the kind of more familiar projects, but I'm showing a streak or a line or a kind of zone inside our own work that is kind of highly personal and that is also very much related to my own education in art and my own kind of sensibility in art. And that sensibility was defined almost completely by the curator Sandberg, who was a contemporary of Pontus Hultin, who was the director of the Stedelijk Museum in Amsterdam, and who organized partly with Pontus Hultin a series of very radical and inspiring exhibitions. What fascinates me now in retrospect is that all these exhibitions took place in a building that was 10 meters by 26 meters. And now it is kind of really unimaginable if we kind of see the vast spaces that are dedicated to art at this moment, that a whole series of revolutionary exhibitions could take place in such a tiny building, kind of not bigger than a provincial school. And nevertheless, clearly the size of the building was actually not an impediment, and I think in many ways it was actually kind of probably an incentive, because it made everything that was held there This is an exhibition, Dilabi. There was an exhibition, Bewogen Beweging, about kind of mobile art. There was a lot of Nikki de Saint-Val and Jean Tanguy. All the typical repertoire. But what was beautiful about this building is that it made everything feel like a laboratory and like a kind of work in progress and like a set, and not didn't ever have the kind of heaviness that we now routinely expect in museums. It's a sign of the times that kind of this small building that was basically here has been replaced by an enormous extension that opened last year. So my sensibility was completely formed by Sandberg, was kind of driven by kind of portable museum of Duchamp, by the kind of compressed and domestic museum of Soane's in London, by Broadhurst. All those kind of things really were profound models for me in terms of thinking of the museum not necessarily as a building, not necessarily as a kind of physical thing, but as a series of conceptual connections that were made either between objects or between people or in time. And so, against the grain, I would say I've tried to be kind of relatively faithful or obstinate in that direction. And that explains why, for instance, in the case of the Serpentine Pavilion, I made a kind of pavilion that was not there to display anything, but simply as a kind of machine to have conversations and to have interviews. We had our 24 London interview marathon. And so that is, you know, one of the undercurrents, or I would say almost unconscious parts of our work. Nevertheless, at some point, when the market economy became more and more strong, and when kind of all museums started to have projects of extensions in which we got involved in many of the competitions. And at some point, I had a kind of shattering discovery that kind of between 95 and 2005, we had designed 34 soccer fields of museum architecture and not kind of built a single one of them. But it also kind of simply showed the enormous escalation of scale and maybe the kind of undesirability of that. In each of the museums, this is the one for the extension of MoMA, we did introduce so-called radical ideas, or at least ideas that were considered too radical. This was an idea that, rather than be submitted to a curatorial kind of regime, or the whims of somebody who organizes an exhibition in a particular sequence, you could also book meetings or book appointments with specific works of art in the storage, or even kind of spend a day in a kind of suite in the museum kind of with five or six or seven items. In an extension for the Whitney Museum, we kind of introduced what is for me still kind of an important kind of maybe distinction and maybe solution for the current confusion of the museum that on one hand still pretends that it kind of is serving a degree of intimacy in terms of the experience of art, but on the other hand, through its sheer size, through the sheer weight of a commercial dimension, is forced to also introduce almost a degree of entertainment. It was, in the Whitney, a simple separation between the two, where certain parts would be of the museum would be hard to reach, and other part of the museum would be kind of incredibly connected and enabling a kind of almost frivolous passage through the entire museum in a kind of minimum of time. So a museum that could be experienced at kind of very different degrees of speed. And that is when we kind of finally participated in the Tate competition. We were also not interested in the monumentality of the existing spaces, but also to introduce for this enormous complex also a series and a sequence of extremely different infrastructures that could enable radically different museum experiences in the same building, from very, very slow to relatively accelerated. Essentially, most of our work as part of this big museum boom has been kind of failure. I think our ideas were always just too radical to be acceptable. In parallel, I've done a number of other kind of things, not very familiar. This is a kind of museum we did in Guangzhou, where I was asked kind of by a developer to do a kind of museum in a new part of the city, and which he wanted me to do on the ground floor in a courtyard, but which I kind of proposed to build on top of his over housing block. Here you see the museum. It was an incredibly exciting kind of situation, because for the first time I had a kind of feeling of actually doing a museum in a place where it was desirable, in a place where it was wanted, in a place where there was interest, and in a place where a kind of incredible variety of audiences. And so it's been a kind of really interesting experience to see with Hu and Lu, how this museum outpost, in a kind of seemingly completely inadequate kind of location, is actually now one of the more compelling art spaces in China, kind of exactly because it is outside every center and outside every urban condition. The other, I would say, much more successful or kind of profound experience in museums I've kind of worked on is an involvement in the Hermitage Museum that started with a visit in 2000 with Frank Gehry here and Tom Krenz, the then director of the Guggenheim Museum. Basically, we were facing the issue of the Hermitage was facing the issue. This is the Hermitage, a former palace, a former art gallery for the Tsars, an official museum built by the Tsars for the population. And here the issue was to incorporate in the Hermitage complex an enormous office building, the general staff building, that was kind of going to be added. And basically, the Guggenheim was kind of thinking that it was going to help the Guggenheim, the Hermitage, to plan it and to conceptualize it. The Hermitage is a literally unbelievable project of unbelievable complexity, or building of unbelievably complexity. The existing complex has 1,200 rooms, and each of these rooms has a kind of different regime of preservation. In other words, some rooms you can do more or less what you want, except change the size of the rooms, but other rooms you have to be unbelievably careful or respectful of kind of existing interiors. And basically, what was going to happen is that to these 1,200, another 800 were going to be added. And those 800 had even kind of more diverse kind of regime of qualities and lesser qualities that were available. Basically, the analysis of Krenz and Gehry was that the museum, among the 2,000 rooms, there was no space big enough for contemporary American art, and that therefore what it needed was kind of bigger spaces for bigger art. So this was the scale. And that enabled me to create my own kind of plan and to separate myself from that particular effort and to conceptualize a project for the Hermitage more or less on my own. Because what I did and what I analyzed is the extremely unusual qualities of the Hermitage Museum in its current situation, or situation then. What you see here is almost completely anathema in terms of museum strategies. You see daylight flooding a space, you see sculptures against a physical background of a national monument. You see kind of badly maintained buildings. And what you see here, the way in which one of the most important paintings of the history of mankind, Malevich Black Square, is hung. Basically, it is hung with a kind of gross label. It has fluorescent light. It is barely protected, and it hangs between two kind of absurd kind of Russian paintings, Russian curtains. But nevertheless, the intensity of the encounter with that painting in that space is more intense than anything I've ever seen or experienced in any of the kind of white spaces or kind of designed museum spaces that we are now involved with. And so it became kind of more and more interesting to kind of think of the Hermitage perhaps as a kind of raw material that did not have to be kind of fixed, that had its own very particular history, the history, of course, of the Tsars, but then the history of the kind of Soviet Union, the neglect of the Soviet army that was kind of stationed here, et cetera, et cetera. All those kind of forms of neglect in the end created a kind of very precise archaeology that I thought was also worth thinking about and worth keeping. And so at some point I made a kind of proposal that perhaps the most disheveled, shabby spaces could be the accommodation where the most exceptional works were displayed, so that you would have a kind of constant double image of, on the one hand, quality and decay as they are kind of related. So that became the kind of approach to the Hermitage. And where I committed myself to not add anything, and at the most to take away, as in this case, a kind of proposal to, in one section, simply eliminate the floors and have a kind of sense of the incredibly diverse section. Another idea that I kind of really proposed with Potowski was still very interesting to me. Instead of taking this 800-room building and converting it into a kind of contemporary museum with a kind of Russian department, an impressionist department, etc., I was imagining that each year the museum could invite 8 artists to make an installation and to keep that installation, so that after 100 years that museum would be the museum of the century. Because it had for every year 8 significant installations that together kind of filled the building to perfection. In other words, it was a kind of sense of delaying occupation and using again the inherent qualities of the building and of its incompleteness as part of the project. Many of the things that we kind of proposed did not happen, and that kind of simply shows, of course, that there is a kind of a relentless drive toward the archetypal model of the kind of contemporary museum, a relentless drive to do new things, to renovate, and to expand, kind of basically. But one thing that we are now doing with a certain amount of success is to look at the complex as a whole. I already mentioned that these are kind of 4 different kind of buildings that are interconnected. And they're so interconnected that actually, if you look at the circulation is a kind of single system that doesn't acknowledge anymore that each of the components is different, and that in a kind of very forceful and enforced experience kind of pushes thousands and thousands of people each day through all the kind of circuits in a kind of very authoritarian and dissatisfying way. And what we are able to do here is that we have convinced Petrovsky that rather than intensify that continuity, we could insist again on the kind of separateness and uniqueness of each of the buildings, and kind of restore their status, this as a palace, this as a kind of small private museum, this as a kind of real museum, and in a way, by disconnecting them again, to kind of restore the kind of perception of each of them as buildings with their own history, their own forms of display, and therefore their own kind of purpose and usefulness. And also in that way, kind of again, extending the time one would have to spend in the Hermitage to get the full experience, or to put it differently, encouraging time spent in one of the detailed parts. In a kind of similar way, with preoccupied with decay, I'm showing a kind of very quick project I'm doing for Dasha Zhukova in Moscow. It's the new house for the garage. The garage is a kind of very excellent organization in Moscow that introduces contemporary art. It was first accommodated in a garage by Melnikov that is turned into a Jewish museum. And now Dasha has kind of found this Russian restaurant in Gorky Park. You can see here the kind of communist landscape of which it was part, with educational and kind of fun elements, and basically a ruin of kind of really unbelievable decay. I've never seen decay at this degree of extremism. And here in the distance you see some of the kind of Soviet kind of iconography that is still present and still not kind of vandalized. Quite beautiful proportions, and that is of course the ironic quality of a lot of Soviet architecture and kind of public generosity, and beautiful views from the ruin to the surrounding park, particularly in the winter when the light is kind of almost horizontal. So all we're doing, almost all we're doing, is a completely minimalistic kind of project. We are wrapping this building in polycarbonate, in many layers of polycarbonate, that kind of filters the light, makes the view slightly more abstract. We have kind of major entrances that can be lifted so that kind of bigger buildings can be, bigger works of art can be entered. You will see kind of some of the interiors, but not quite everything. And basically, we convinced Dasha that actually the Soviet iconography will kind of stay around and continue to play a role in the experience of the garage. And here we made a kind of very precise documentation of the walls, the graffiti on the walls, but also the kind of original materials. And I find it really very surprising to find a patron that actually went along with this approach, simply, I think, out of an awareness that actually, even if history is not particularly glamorous, is not particularly attractive, it is almost per se and for its own sake worth keeping and at least worth referring to. I now move to Syria, where just before the current civil war, we were involved as part of a number of other architects in a combined effort by the Louvre and the Aga Khan Foundation to think of a museum of archaeology. Our first notion was to not do anything new, but looking in Damascus, we saw a kind of very an unfinished parking garage, unfinished office building from the 70s that can, for some reason, had never been concluded. A very impressive structure. And so initially, and this is, you know, kind of part of the kind of constant reluctance to play the obvious role of the architect as the kind of extravagant waste of means, and trying to find a kind of more rational step to try to accommodate in this building, you know, the entire program of the archaeology museum. That was not thinkable, unfortunately. And then we were part of a competition with other architects to really think about a new museum on a new site. This is the old museum. This is the site with Metropolitan and Bilbao on it. And we started, of course, looking at the scale of objects that needed to be kind of built there, accommodated there, the nature of the objects, and the density of objects that we could assume. This is the density of the Louvre, typically. This is the density of the Met. This is the density of the Metropolitan. So it's a kind of beautiful sense of how museums do have a kind of interior idea of population and fullness. And what we then kind of proposed is something that, again, was a refusal to be an architect in the typical way and to propose an amazing shape and an amazing content and something amazing, but to look whether we could develop something much more modest, where we would look at a kind of landscape of very small 4x4x4 meter cubes that could kind of somehow be spread over the entire area, and that could each accommodate kind of different parts of the program. So it could be either a display feature, it could be a storage feature, it could be a kind of balcony, it could be a cabin, it could be a kind of staircase. So what we thought would be interesting is to simply revisit the idea of the kind of modular again, combined perhaps with the notion of poverty, or at least not luxurious kind of standards of building, where eventually you could have a kind of entire accumulation of these prefab elements that was actually very rigorous, but that if you kind of visited would look like a kind of very improvised, almost archaeological site in the middle of the city. And then there were some kind of covers that could enable certain parts to be actually interior, but that could also maintain other people, other sections as exteriors. Still one of my favorite kind of projects. So I will end with two projects that I'm doing now. I'm aware that I did it deliberately because we are in Europe, so my lecture is actually almost melancholy about the kind of powers of architecture, the kind of ambitions of architecture, the kind of realism of architecture, because I think that that is the kind of message that is fit for Europe. But of course, it's not the entire world that is kind of living in the kind of same or similar regime. And you only have to travel to Doha to kind of realize that they're a completely different reality, or to China, of course, but a completely different reality is taking place. And it is a kind of reality, in my view, where culture is being kind of reinvented in a completely new way. One of the things that is in itself always surprising but impressive about the Middle East is that in each of the Middle Eastern countries, a local population of in the case of Dar, 300,000, accommodates a total of 15, a million and a half of guests. So there is a kind of incredible proportion between the locals and the non-locals that in countries like ours would lead to complete catastrophe or would be completely unimaginable. Kind of somehow there it's kind of thinkable and kind of workable. One of the things that interests me in Doha is that it seems as if it's a country that is establishing a kind of equivalence of a number of values or a number of subjects that we typically keep very separate. There's politics, but there's sports. This is the emir with kind of Frank de Boer, the trainer of Ajax, and there's art. And I have a kind of very strong feeling that kind of what is happening in Doha is that all these domains that we keep separate are actually being blurred into a continuous kind of spectrum where each of them is supposed to interact and be part of all the others in a kind of much more continuous bent width of meaning and value. And it's for me very interesting to be part of that kind of thinking. And I'm not showing a lot because I cannot show a lot. This is the kind of public realm in Doha. It isn't Anish Kapoor, it's at least kind of a more ambitious challenge. And so one thing that these are kind of some of the things we have the opportunity to be active in there. And this is one maybe new kind of form of cultural institution that we are hoping to plan, which is on the interface of an airport and a city. Typically, the two worlds are kept separate, but in this, in the case of Doha, there is a kind of 5 kilometer line where the two are basically developed at the same time and are developed as a kind of constant and deliberate juxtaposition where the advantages of the two conditions can be constantly used by the different entities. And what we are trying to do here is to think of a kind of art institution that can be partly storage, partly a free zone, kind of partly on the airport and partly kind of relatively private, but also has a kind of public face, also has a kind of situation where elements here can be there, also has kind of moments where this can be public. So it's a kind of maybe a new kind of form of indeterminate use of the two conditions, also having legal repercussions in a kind of single entity, so that a whole band of activities can be kind of arranged there in a way that I think could be genuinely new, kind of maybe not in terms of architecture, but simply in terms of the combination. I want to end with a kind of totally kind of unrelated kind of project, which is a kind of very optimistic kind of project, and which is the first time that we are designing something. We are working for Noel for their 75th birthday, and basically they came to us with these models and said they wanted us to invent versions of each of these typologies. And I thought that actually what they had kind of produced was so interesting that I decided to create kind of something with minimal amount of change and kind of simply have a kind of almost direct translation of these kind of generic entities into the model. And this is perhaps the one that is kind of so far the most exciting. Noel has a theory that kind of in the future or even currently, a lot of interaction and a lot of work will take place not on tables, but on kind of breast height elements that enable you to kind of be more quick and more immediate that enables you to kind of put your laptop kind of in here and interact in a kind of very quick manner. It's part of the new ideology of new work, and whether it is actually a true observation or whether it is in the end a kind of indirect way of trying to shrink the workspace constantly and make work kind of more economic is not very clear. But anyway, we took the form, and what we did is kind of introduce a wall-like element. But each of the elements in that wall can use independently of each other. And so the moment you kind of think of that or do that, kind of it becomes from a very predictable kind of situation. It becomes an unpredictable situation that can then be used in many kind of different forms. Almost spontaneously, this is kind of one of the first prototypes that immediately became accommodated as a kind of lunch type. It's a very refined technology, very high, ambitious engineering, but we will not show the engineering. On the contrary, it will be have a kind of look no hands kind of situation. This is a kind of further prototype, and these are kind of some of the more extreme ways in which this kind of full furniture can actually kind of be unstable and stable at the same time. Thank you.
Do we have another microphone? Thank you so much for this rich lecture. There is a possibility for anyone to ask questions, but maybe I'll just start. It was a topic discussed a lot when we opened the Corbusier show, the relationship between things like this, what you just did, a lecture, and also other kinds of statements, manifestos, books, that is was so much a part of Corbusier's world. And I've been wondering, in your case, that some of your books are as influential and as well-known, I think, as the buildings almost. Mm. Is it maybe too big a question, but I would still want to ask you a little bit about the relationships between these two, these levels.
Well, I think that you didn't say in your in your introduction that I wasn't always an architect, but I was a kind of writer first. And I think that that basically enabled me to describe the kind of role and kind of architect I wanted to become, first in words, and in words that were relatively compelling, so that I could occupy the, and our office could occupy the space that we described first as a kind of theoretical condition. And in that sense, we did that first with kind of metropolitan architecture, which was done in 75, and in 75, the word metropolitan was a kind of horror word, and therefore, you know, it would need a kind of really an incredibly strong advocacy and strong evidence of something plausible to overcome the incredible prejudice that was then existing against kind of artificiality. And in a certain way, we have been able to use writing constantly as a form of anticipating on what we want to do. You know that we've done, and veneers in the kind of room, a number of almanacs, where we were kind of simply looking at the kind of Middle East beyond the kind of caricature of, you know, it's all one big kind of vulgar domain. And that also then kind of enabled us to cherry pick in the kind of Middle Eastern context, perhaps a number of more significant trends or significant possibilities. And I would say that this constant alternation is for me, a very viable and vital part of influencing what an architect can do and what you yourself can do. Because in a certain way, I think that what I was trying to do is to kind of really suggest that although maybe you have a feeling that, you know, that we are incredibly spoiled people that can kind of do exactly what they want without taking into account what anyone else might have to say or might have to. We are actually kind of really very much constrained by very limited expectations. In order to kind of really break out, I felt that so far writing has been very productive. Whether that will stay the same is, of course, very debatable, because you get a sense that the importance of writing is declining anyway. But for the time being, it works.
It was interesting to be reminded of small, modest spaces like the original Stedelijk, and it goes for this museum too, actually, in the history. I just read about two projects, one very well known already, the fact that you're going to do the next architecture biennial, but less well known, also Venetian project, is that you're involved with recreating one of the most legendary post-war exhibitions, When Attitudes Become Form, the first conceptual art exhibition in Europe, or the first survey. You kind of avoided maybe to talk about exhibitions, but I'm very interested, of course, in what it is to, why it is that you're so interested in exhibitions, it seems to me, and also what it could be to actually make exhibitions that are not only architecture, because every exhibition is an architectural project, but to actually show architecture in the show.
Well, I think that, like books, exhibitions are incredibly productive ways of producing architectural ideas and producing architectural polemics. And recently our office has been kind of very active, you know, either in the art or the architectural biennale to talk about specific and limited issues in a way that enables us to put those issues on the agenda. Kind of when near last year kind of talked about the architect as a civil servant or the civil servant as an architect. That was kind of showed that simply created evidence of a kind of very rich body of work that is now being kind of destroyed typically, and that has an enormous value that has to be kind of reasserted. I used the exhibition of Venice to raise the issue of preservation. So it's again a very great tool to say things, to communicate ideas. With attitudes become form. It's more a kind of ongoing kind of work with Prada, where we do almost everything between kind of fashion shows, involvement, temporary exhibitions, and so we I find it kind of very exciting to do whatever they ask, and to find for anything they ask a kind of solution.
It's an unusual thing. One often reintroduces artists and individual art pieces, but to actually reproduce, if I understand correctly what you're doing, an entire exhibition is something I've hardly ever heard of, actually.
Well, I think it's a mythical exhibition. Any picture you see of it is kind of incredibly suggestive, particularly for somebody of my generation. But apparently, an enormous amount of the kind of work still exists, and so that simply made us kind of wonder.
Some of the work is in our museum. Questions, comments? Whilst people are thinking, Do we have one more?
I was a bit puzzled by the story, because you were you started with it was called the Grand Palais. Is it called Grand Palais in France, in Paris? where you had this immense building, but still you had this very experimental, almost low-key, very busy space, everything happening. And that there was something that you, it seemed in the last project, there was something that you wanted to see happening in the building. What I don't see then is why this immense space would be the one who is to blame, the immense architecture, the power architecture. It seems more that this balloon of the art, the power art, that one is bursting, that one is exploding.
Yeah.
But the architecture itself is can be.
No. In this case, there was no kind of problem of the architecture at all. It was kind of simply, as you say, the kind of scale of the art is kind of bursting and under its own weight. So this is not connected, as far as I'm concerned, with the kind of crisis of architecture at all. It's the maybe if that is not clear, I would say that kind of the moment we started to consider architecture as a kind of completely personal kind of expression, at the surface, not necessarily of a kind of public good, but as in this case, of the kind of Guggenheim brand, and where we, whether we wanted or not, collectively entered a kind of point of no return that is described here, then the kind of problem starts with the architecture.
But is it then also that you want to find some kind of way to build more humble architecture to tame this power art?
Yeah, well, there is, and I'm happy that you use the word humble, because there is a kind of humility in kind of a lot of what I am doing. Yeah? And I'm using my own, I'm saying I, in this case, kind of deliberately. It's not kind of something that I have kind of a reputation for, but I would say that this is a kind of humble kind of statement. The kind of building in China is also kind of a humble statement, and it's definitely true that we are kind of looking for occasions where we can de-escalate the obligation for extravagance that now is part of the kind of architectural kind of moment.
Questions? Whilst we're waiting, I'll do what I'm not allowed to do, because I know you cannot speak about the Venice Biennale, but I saw the title and it's called Fundamentals. Mm-hmm. What does that mean?
We can talk about it. Okay. Yeah, it's not a problem. Basically, I think that the problem of the architectural biennale has been that more and more it has followed the model of the art biennale. Art biennale kind of basically artists are invited, their galleries kind of pay for the installation, etc. Everyone lives happily ever after. And the same model was kind of chosen for the art biennale, where again architects are invited. Make the statement at large expense. And so when I opened the kind of first conversations with the Biennale, when they were interested in asking me, I said I was interested in two conditions. One, that I had more time, not 9 months, but at least a year and a half. And also that I could completely disconnect the Biennale from the contemporary. So that is the key thing. It will not be about contemporary architecture. And what we are doing in the kind of center pavilion is basically to have a kind of very rigorous and kind of fundamental look at a number of traditional architectural elements, such as the floor, the kind of ceiling, the wall, things that typically are considered almost beyond discussion. But actually, if you kind of really look, for instance, at the space between the ceiling and the kind of floor, there's a kind of enormous, inaccessible, dark territory where so much happens. And if you kind of look at the history, you're not only kind of looking at kind of contemporary lighting conditions or air conditioning conditions, but if you go back in history 400 years, you're in Michelangelo's kind of Sixtine Chapel. So we are trying to make that whole trajectory kind of through history and through all the cultures of the world. And what, because what we want to do is, this is now a door, and it's kind of almost a universal definition of a door. It has a handle. But if you look at all the earlier versions of doors, they kind of are literally five, countless, but thousands and thousands of other models, kind of models that had kind of more ceremonial, that had more depth, models that had kind of more symbolism. And so it's simply trying to document architecture's former richness or potential richness. It's maybe a very utopian project, huh?
You want the microphone?
In one way, it's hard to ask questions, and this seems like a more fun, really fun to discuss about the Biennale. This is a question about the lecture, so it's not a great question, but no one's asking any questions, which you do. And in one way, it harps on a really old thing, but maybe it's okay to ask. So, I really enjoyed the lecture, and I listened kind of carefully. I think it's really interesting in architectural rhetoric when you jump from we to I. I know it's kind of an old chestnut, but in some way that it's in the context of the biggest eye in the 20th century, I guess, in architecture, in terms of the Corbusier and the eye in architecture is introduced. And it's a very well-known thing in architectural discourse, but starting with Alberti, the eye of the architect. And I thought, I suppose I could formulate the question simply, because it seems to me that you choose words really carefully. When you talked about the Hermitage, you said eye. And you actually said, I practically on my own about this project, which sounds like the most complicated, the project must have involved the most actors of any. And when you talked about the non-project, you absolutely talked about we. And you didn't mention that. Yeah. And I'd just like to hear that. How for you does the jump happen, and what does it mean?
So basically, I'm a kind of real we person because I am deeply convinced that kind of most architecture needs a collective intelligence to be defined, developed, criticized, and established. Yeah. All those are kind of very different things. And that is why I have worked so hard on the kind of creation of Office for Metropolitan Architecture, because already in the beginning I was aware that it would be better to introduce a we as a kind of envelope in which almost any configuration of people could operate. As you kind of probably know, we now have seven partners that actually kind of run the entire office together, and there are associates. It really is a completely collective enterprise, where the best ideas, I would also say, are shared ideas, and ideas where it's not even possible anymore to separate them and say, this is yours. In this particular case, it really started with a kind of visit, and it started with a kind of an intimate relationship with Petrovsky that I was able to establish in a kind of most grotesque situation, where we were first together in Las Vegas, where Tom Krenz had kind of convinced him to open a kind of dependence of the Hermitage, then. Where there was this kind of visit of Gary and Krenz to Petersburg, where they were kind of basically suggesting that they could leave the Hermitage like a few silk screens and they would be happily initiate a Museum of Modern Art. And so it's really based on a very personal relationship, and that's also why I say it hasn't been very successful. It's kind of really a way of thinking together with Potocki and some of his team about what he could do with the entire museum. And sometimes it works and sometimes it doesn't work for thousands of reasons, but it is a kind of an eye situation, I would say. And the furniture is absolutely not an eye situation because, you know, if I could show you the kind of almost hundreds of engineers that are kind of working on something, it's amazing.
Okay, I have one question. When you work with decay,
where is the question?
I was wondering how can you frame decay without taking away what's exciting?
Yeah, that's a very good question. Yeah, whether you can use it and be successful, or whether your only kind of responsible attitude should be to abstain and leave something kind of decayed is still not clear. But I would say that in the context of our work on preservation, which I hope to kind of really develop in the next 2 or 3 years, we are also interested in seeing whether you could actually add to the architectural repertoire something that abstains. Because I think that there's something really strange about the way the architectural profession is configured. We are always assumed to change a situation that we find. There is simply no part of our repertoire that can say, interesting situation, but no thanks, or interesting situation, but you should not change it, because then, you know, as an architect, you obviously have failed. So, and that is kind of one of the reasons that we tried to, founded AMO, to extend the repertoire of the architect, at least with a legitimate domain where you can abstain from action and think. And then, you know, whether we can develop that into kind of something more strong or more compelling or more creative, or remains to be seen.
Any further questions? What I didn't mention is that this evening is a collaboration. It's not only Moderna Museet that invited Rem Koolhaas. I want to thank the Stockholms Arkitekturförening and KTH, KTH Arkitekturskolan, and Oscar Properties for bringing Rem here. I think we simply close it here. I'm so happy you came. Thank you.
Thank you.